ballroom dancing cool again? Strictly Ballroom hit our screens nearly 25 years ago, but its star, Paul Mercurio, has established a career far beyond the sparkle of the dance floor. And Craig Bennett recently caught up with the dance star for this Studio 10 exclusive. Love is in the air.
It's been almost 25 years since Paul Mercurio danced his way onto our screens in the hit Aussie movie Strictly Ballroom. And with a career spanning over 35 years, Paul confesses it all began with the gyrating moves of the great Elvis Presley.
It was after watching that movie that I turned around to my mum and said, "Mum, can I do ballet?" And a cigarette fell out of her mouth and she burned a hole in the carpet. Back in the old days, in the 70s, Saturday afternoon movies. You had Danny Kaye and you had Shirley MacLaine and you had all those great old musicals playing, and without a doubt, they all inspired me. But it was after that Elvis movie that I said to Mum, "I want to dance."
Take me back to those early years as a kid. Times were tough.
I didn't go up the shops for a year because the local gang wanted to beat me up because I did ballet. When I did become a dancer, I got bullied by gay people wanting to, you know, impress upon me that I was gay, and then I had all the other guys who thought I was gay that wanted to beat me up, and Billy Elliot. You know, when that film came out, I went, that's my story.
But Paul was destined for the stage and soon found himself front and centre with the prestigious Sydney Dance Company.
You know, I was 10 years with Sydney Dance Company. I like to think of it as the golden years of the dance company, and maybe they were. They were to me. There was a really fun time, hard work. We had some great tours, some big fights, you know, all of that sort of stuff. There's a lot of love, laughter, and, you know, a bit of shouting and a bit of blood and quite a few tears. And it was a very intense time. I got a phone call from this rather weird bloke saying, "Oh, my name's Baz Luhrmann and I'm doing a movie about a ballroom dancer and I'd be interested in you doing some choreography." But then a year later he rang again and said, "Look, I've got the money for the movie. I'd like you actually to come and audition, you know." And I went, oh, yeah, I guess. So I did a bit of a dance routine, did a bit of scene work with Tara and Baz, and long story short, I was cast.
"Fran, I want to dance with you. If you're lost, you can look and you will find
me, time after time." It was beautifully cast. Did you make some great friends on the set of that movie?
We were a family. I've been in, you know, 11 or 12 movies, and, you know, none of them have been like Strictly, because with Strictly there were some people that have, you know, had done quite a bit, you know, Bill Hunter and Barry Otter and Shirley Thompson, and then there were people that it was their first time, you know, so myself and Tara, and I'm sure G had done some stuff prior. We all knew we were making something special.
Was Baz Luhrmann a tough director? I know it was his movie debut, as it was yours.
Baz worked really well. He was very thoughtful, and when he needed to get something, it was great to work with him, because it was a collaboration, you know, you really work together. It was quite funny, we did a scene where I was looking out of the curtains when Sonia and Todd do the fruity rumba, and Baz was always so loved that close-ups, they were just crazy, and he's very intent on getting expressions, and he wanted me to think with my eyes and just squint them slightly. He got down on his hands and knees and held my thumb, and he said, when I squeeze your finger, just squint it gently. So, you know, he was quite creative in getting things he needed, and I knew then, you know, that Baz was weird. "You won't admit you love me." Baz is a bit of a genius, and that can come across as being slightly strange or whatever.
Do you two keep in touch?
Sadly, no.
Why not?
Well, you know, sometimes Hollywood beckons and
it gets in the way.
When we did the film, it was good. We used to play golf together on the weekend sometimes, but no. Action!
Hollywood also beckoned, and when a call came through from Pretty Woman director Gary Marshall, Paul turned down the lead role in the Aussie smash hit Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, and headed for Tinseltown.
And so I said no to Priscilla, and the main reason for that is Strictly Ballroom finally made it okay for a bloke to dance. To me, that was an incredibly important thing, knowing what it was like as a kid and a guy, you know, to dance. Exit to Eden didn't work.
Why not?
I don't think you can make a family S&M movie.
But soon he was back on home turf, mentoring the next generation of Aussie dancers. Now, you're a judge on Dancing with the Stars. What's the truth about your departure from that show?
Have you not read my website? I actually put something up and my manager said, "Take that down, you can't say that." I went, "Well, it's bloody true." The way they went about it, they knew they weren't going to offer me a contract in May, but they waited until August, a week before shooting, before they told me. So that's the politics and the crap of it. But when they said we won't be needing Paul, I rang up, you know, the head honcho and said, well, you know, why me? Why not Todd or Mark or Helen? I mean, why me? And word for word, he said, I'm sorry, Paul, you're just too nice, you're too genuine. When we first started, we were a good balance. But then I do think it becomes not about a feel-good story about people getting better. It becomes more about the bitchy comment or the arguing.
Your father was Gus Mercurio, famous character actor. We saw him in everything. But yet you really didn't have much of a relationship.
I don't ever really remember missing him, you know. And when he did come over, I was a little bit more protective and, you know, he'd sit in the main chair and I'd go, what are you sitting in the main chair for? You know, sit in the beanbag, that's my, you know, all that sort of stuff. I do remember going to school one day and there was a kid at school whose dad was a newsreader. And I remember going, geez, I wish my dad was on TV. And then, of course, the next thing, Dad's on TV.
Charlie.
He passed away when?
2010. But I always remember my very last lunch with him. I walked away from that lunch and I kind of knew it was the last time I was going to see him. And I think he knew too. I still picture him, you know, leaning against the restaurant wall.
You've endured the heart-wrenching family tragedy of your brother's death. What happened?
Well, sadly, he had some kind of a breakdown many years ago. You know, he never kind of recovered. For some strange reason, there was wires loose and he was just never able to get them fixed. So, sadly, he lived with a lot of pain and he just really wanted the pain to stop. Didn't really want to die. I was at home and I was at the backyard and I was having a good old cry and I was drinking a beer and I'd just mown the lawn. And the bees were buzzing. It was a beautiful day in the country where I lived. You'd smell the grass and the fresh flowers. And I was having a cry and I thought, why couldn't he be happy? And then I'd think about him and have a laugh. To me, in that moment, I discovered happiness is a choice. And there's, you know, it's a really important thing to remember. But now that's a kind of a motto I live with and I try to share with people too. Happiness is a choice. There is only one choice. And that's what I try and live by. I think my Twitter handle is once could dance, now can cook.
Backed by a highly successful performing career, Paul turned his hand to the culinary delights of the kitchen.
How many cookbooks have you written now?
I've kind of written 2.5 because Mercurio's Menu was based on the first 2 episodes of Mercurio's Menu, and I think 3/4 of the recipes are mine.
So, you're going to whip me up a sticky date pudding?
Cake mixer out.
Yes.
We're going to cream the butter.
Beautiful. So that's softened butter, is it?
Softened butter.
Excellent.
We cream that. Brown sugar goes in.
Excellent.
Cream it. 1 egg at a time.
Yes.
Beaten beautifully. Once all that's mixed, we put the dates and the mixture into that. Give it a mix. Fold through our flour.
Yes.
Put it in the cake tin. We have sticky date pudding.
It sounds very easy, doesn't it, Paul?
Smells great.
God, it does. It smells divine. And I watched you do that. That was effortless, wasn't it?
It's an easy cake to make, as all the recipes in my cookbooks are, if I may say so.
Mmm. Oh, wow. That is feather light.
Mmm.
Melt in your mouth magic. That is incredible.
Mm.
You could only possibly get a 10 out of 10 for that.
I reckon I'd get a chef's apron for this.
No, I'd give you a dozen.
Belgium, Germany and the Czech Republic in October. So if you'd like to join him or find out more, you can head to his website. It sounds like a lot of fun.